While people are still taking up their teacups outside, I'll take this opportunity to have a very quick introduction around the table. So as you can see, probably the average age of the dais has all of a sudden fallen down by about 25 odd years. So we have got one veteran, but the rest of us, I think, would be in mid-30s, early-30s, some maybe even in 20s. So I hope to have a very energetic discussion, completely matched by Gautam Samanta sir's enthusiasm as well. So this session is, as the agenda reads, it's about data analytics, it's about emerging technologies, it's about Internet of Things, and how a new era of operation and maintenance is being ushered by use of these new age technologies. Not so far back, O&M was mostly confused with cleaning panels and cutting grass, right? So as long as you are cleaning panels and as long as you are cutting grass, you are probably one of the good O&M contractors. In that sense, we actually made a couple, in the beginning years of our business, we made a couple of pull calls to these 2.5 megawatt kind of players who had set up the plants back in 2009-2010, asking them that, can we do O&M for you? And they were like, aapke paas kitna labor hai? Agar aapke paas itna labor hai, to aap din mein kitne panels, kitne plates clean kar payenge? Right? So as long as you were cleaning panels and as long as you were cutting grass, that was enough. The good part is that now the industry has realized that there's a lot more to do to O&M, and I'm sure that will come out in the panel. A little bit about ourselves. I am Puneet Jaggi. I represent the Gensol Group. Gensol Group is probably one of the largest, if not the largest, consultant in the country for solar projects with about 8,000 megawatts in our kitty. We are again, if not the largest, one of the largest operation and maintenance players with a portfolio of almost 2,000 megawatts in India. And with our global joint venture partners, we are maintaining about 3.5 gigawatts across 27 countries. That makes us the third largest operator of solar assets globally. So with that background, we had been in a unique stage where we were able to see the trajectory of the Indian solar market right from 2008, which was the beginning years of solar, to 2017-2018 now. And what is interesting is that the operation and maintenance has always followed the trajectory of pricing. What I mean by that is that we were having 18 rupee PPAs to begin with back in 2009 when we had the IREDA policy, 17.91 rupee PPAs. Now we have a 2.5 rupee PPA. And the rule of thumb says that if you were getting an 18 rupee PPA, you could spend 18 crores on a project. And if you're getting a 2.5 rupee PPA, probably you can only spend 2.5 crores on the project in order to make some return. The other rule of thumb in the O&M space is that the cost of O&M is typically 1% of the capital cost that you put in, which means that probably at the time of 18 rupee PPA, people were able to command a cost of 18 lakh rupees a megawatt, which made sense considering that the project size was only about 1 megawatt, 2 megawatt at the time. But today, when it is a 2.5 rupee PPA, people are expecting the prices would go down to 2.5 lakhs per megawatt. Now, this is an interesting conundrum to have, an interesting irony, because there's a clear reason why 18 became 2.5 when it came to the project tariffs. In the beginning, it was because the government wanted to incentivize the risk takers, the bold risk takers who came into the solar sector. So that's why the 18 rupee tariff. As the time went by, it was about oversupply in the global market, which led to the tariff drops from 18 to 10 rupees, for example. Then as the time went further by, the drop in fundamentally, the development in technology and the drop in silicon rates from about $400 a kg to about $23 a kg. So that led to some reduction in pricing. Then the scales went bigger. Instead of 5 megawatt, we were looking at 50 megawatts, 100 megawatts, 300 megawatts projects being set up. In case of Adani, 648 megawatt project being set up. In case of Greenko, 810 megawatt project being set up. So that kind of led to a reduction of pricing. And more recently, in the last 2 years, what we have seen is that the very, very innovative financial engineering has led to the reduction of pricing further, wherein we are able to reduce the interest cost, we are able to increase the debt amount, and as a result, have some better expectations of IRRs. So these were all the reasons why the pricing has actually come down when it comes to the cost of setting up of a project. But I'm not able to understand that what leads to the price reduction when it comes to operation and maintenance, because about 70 to 80% of the cost in operation and maintenance is manpower cost. You have to clean modules, you have to use either labor for that, or you have to use module cleaning pipelines, which will again be linked to labor. You have to provide security to the plant, which is again largely manual when it comes to the Indian circumstances. You have to provide technical services on the site, which is project managers, site engineers, technicians that you need to keep on site, which is again manpower. The only thing which is not manpower linked is probably HV maintenance. That is the once in a year testing that you need to have of your transformer and breakers, etc. The tools that you want to provide and the guest house and the transportation. But these three things combined account for less than 20% of the O&M pie. So 80% is manpower, and manpower cost grows every year. Manpower cost does not come down every year, right? But nevertheless, from an expectation of about 18 lakh rupees a megawatt, today we are at an expectation of 2.5 lakh rupees a megawatt. Monica ma'am pointed out in the last panel, if we were able to get a 5 lakh rupee per megawatt or 7 lakh rupee a megawatt cost, we would consider ourselves damn lucky, because we'll be making a killing margin. Over here, we are being killed. Right, so the only real way wherein we can actually match the expectations of the market, where we can get to a point of 2.5 lakh rupees or even lower when it comes to O&M pricing, is by use of the latest in technology. And an interesting benchmark that we use internally to measure that is by deployment of better technology and by deployment of better processes, how much manpower per megawatt have we been able to reduce? So in India, I would imagine that there is one person for every 3 megawatts on an average, which means if it's a 100 megawatt plant, you'll have about 30, 35 people on site. And this is only the technical staff I'm talking about. However, globally, probably the benchmark is more in the case of one person for every 10 megawatt or even lesser. So internally, we started that as a benchmark, and instead of one person for every 3 megawatt, we are already at about one person for every 7 megawatt in India. And that happens by usage of better technology. To give a simple reference, we have got SenseHawk, which will talk about usage of drones, I imagine, in thermographic inspections, project construction, and so on. So to give you a very easy understanding, it takes a drone probably one day to do a thermographic inspection of about 10 to 15 megawatts of projects. Manually, with a handheld camera, it would take us, even on a sample basis, at least 20 to 25 days in order to do that. Right, so that's the kind of difference that new technology brings in. Similarly, about 2 years back, we were using Excel sheets. We were using preventive maintenance Excel sheet, a corrective maintenance Excel sheet, a spare part Excel sheet, in order to be able to do operation and maintenance properly on site. Whereas today, we are using platforms. Right, so we have got somebody from Locus Energy, which I imagine is going to shed some more light on usage of platforms for better and more technology-driven operation maintenance. These platforms in themselves have got the O&M automation and machine learning built in, wherein you can actually do predictive maintenance and condition-based maintenance instead of blanketly cleaning 18 times module cleaning in a year, or 24 times module cleaning in a year. You actually do module cleaning when it is required to be done. Right, so we have got somebody from Locus who I imagine would talk about that. We've got somebody from DuPont who would, the most trusted name on quality in solar and in other sectors for more than a century now. So we'll get to understand what is the latest in technology. Tata Power has been a veteran when it comes to solar projects, or the power projects in general and solar projects in particular. And going by the quick scan on the resume I had of Gautam Sir is having probably the richest experience. My age probably would be lesser than Gautam Sir's experience in the solar sector, so would love to hear some more thoughts on that as well. With that, I'll conclude my speech, and I would request Gautam Sir to please take the stage and enlighten us about the latest in O&M.
Just one second.
The technical time limit for the session is 10 minutes per independent speaker. We don't have a bell, so I won't be ringing that, but every speaker who exceeds that time limit per limit, one coffee per room gets added.
Okay, good morning, everybody. So I'm from Orange Renewable Power. As you know, Orange Renewable more on the wind side, almost like 800 megawatt, and on the solar side is less than 200 megawatt. The overall portfolio is less than a 1 gigawatt level. So my experience is I am just 25 years running, you know, from 93 onwards in photovoltaic, but most of the times I was in the manufacturing. And I am to be privileged, like I have already audited at least 10 top manufacturing companies in India, and total another top tier one companies, maybe 20 in China. You know, let us try to see, you know, how we can bring the values, you know, in O&M with this kind of module experience, you know. Okay, the overview I would like to take, see the services and the issues, you know, what we face, and then what are the different challenges, what is the quality assurance that we can bring to the modules, and optimizing the power plant performance. So in the services list, if we see, the plant operations is the main, you know, where we can earn the revenue. But to earn that one, you know, we have to have, you know, the plant maintenance, the site maintenance. We'll go into the details on that, you know. And then performance of the whole in it, how it generates, you know, and the module cleaning, how we have to do with the module cleaning, what is 10 days or fortnightly or every month, you know, there will be some reference module, you know, from that we have to see the soiling as per the different locations. Then safety and the security is the most important factor, you know, that for their power plant, you know. Then how do you maintain your different inventory management, how you, you know, train your manpower for the training. And there are some maybe the local issues, you know. So the key services, like in the plant operations, we have seen the performance monitoring and the analysis, you know. This performance monitoring mostly it performs on the database management and the reporting, you know, how we generate the overall power. Now we'll come down to the point, like, you know, the performance ratio, the capacity utilization factor, and the different auxiliary consumption as well, you know. But there are some issues on the detections and the diagnostics. There are different tools that we have, you know, and how we, you know, use those tools and get these things, you know. Remote monitoring, how we, through the SCADA, the SCADA systems, you know, how you did the data and how you analyze the whole thing, you know. So module cleaning and the scheduling, as I told you, you know, this is also a relative part, and we have to see that how the soil is, you know, have the impact on your, the generations according to you do the cleaning, you know. There are different ways of the cleaning as well, you know. The plant maintenance, like, you know, schedule for preventive maintenance, you know, so if you take care, you know, certain preventive maintenance, so your operating of the whole plant will be, you know, the cuff will be going half, you know, the capacity utilization factor, you know. Then the corrective and the preventing obviously is another point, you know, like any other in the manufacturing unit, you know. The spare parts and inventory is a main part, you know. You have to have, you know, spare modules, you know. One of the things, if the module goes wrong, or if anything's in the data card, you know, on the or inverter or any other electronic part, that you have to have. Then site inspections means green cover and the vegetation. This is also a very, very important factor. I'll show you some of the graphs, you know, how you impact on your, you know, kind of a hotspot or a kind of a generations, you know. The infrastructure management is also very important. Site security and the site surveillance, as you know, because you have to deploy at least, you know, for a 20 megawatt, a kind of a power plant, something like 16 to 20, you know, the persons operating out 8 hours or maybe 12 hours in the shift, you know. So security sites, you have to have a, you know, the most important part. Then water management, most of the cleaning that what we do is a water-based cleaning that, but there are some adverse effect on that, you know, particularly on the anti-reflection coating of the module, you know. Then waste management, you know, how you do with this kind of the water, and what will be the kind of the drainage and all, you know. The key performance areas, which is the PR, you know, we like to see that, you know, if the plant is giving a 80% on that, you know, then we see, yes, it is generating a good, you know, the power output, you know. Then the cuff is also, we have to see, you know, where is the number is. Is it like in like 25% of that or 22, 24? So above 20, maybe 24, 25 is a right number, you know. We have to see that the auxiliary consumption. Auxiliary consumption means if, you know, there is a tracker-based unit, you know, you have to see that how much power it also take, you know. So those are the factors, you know, that you have to, the key service areas. Issues, most of the issues comes in the module, you know. In the module means, you know, the first is the power warranty, you know. So you have a legal contract, you know, where you have given, like, in the warranty, there is a two things. One is that the product, something like, you know, some of the manufacturers give the 10 years, somebody is giving the 12 years. So product warranty is very, very important, you know, because this will give, in case of any kind of the module has got problem, you know, so it has to be replaced by the manufacturers. Then the performance warranty. Performance is very important, like, you know, 25 years is a convention, but there are some manufacturers given 27 years. Some of the manufacturers are also coming up with a new technology like 30 years, you know. We will see in the degradations pattern, you know. So initially the first year degradation is 2.5% and subsequent year is 0.7%. But there are some Indian manufacturers who are giving 27 years of, you know, the product performance. And initial degradations is 2.5% the first year, and subsequent is 0.67%, or in the other hand, 0.03%, you know, is the benefit on the year-on-year basis, you know. So we have to see that how the modules is getting defect, but I have some sort of a, on the a quality side, to ensure that, that the module defects can be minimized, you know. The glass breakers, these are the teething trouble, you know, initially when you install the, you know, your power plant, that after 3 months or 5 months, or whatever the problem will come, the initial problem will come, there are a lot of micro cracks issues, you know. We will see in a photograph, you know, how the micro cracks, it happens, and how to prevent this kind of activity, what kind of hotspot, if this hotspots because of the sidewing, and how it curves because of the bar drop or any other undesired, you know, the kind of the sidewing and the central trail, you know, these are the issues, you know, that is comes. The other issues, something like, you know, the card failure in the inverter, the transformer, something like the oil leakage and all, cable burnt, you know, rusting of the nut bolts in the structure, or sometimes in the theft, you know. So key challenges, like, you know, the optimum power generations. To have the optimum power generations, you know, we have to have irradiance. Irradiance is coming. You see, everywhere you have to have a PVC data you have analyzed, and you have initially thought that this is the kind of the generations, you know. So in the irradiance, you have to see and continuously monitoring, you know, like what is that GHI. And from the GHI, if it is a tracker or if it is a tilt angle, so how it's transplitting into GTI, you know. So this irradiance is very, very important. Then you have to have an IV curve and the voltage and the tilt angle, you know, at different seasons, that how you optimize your whole power generations. The cable and the interconnect reliability is also very, very important, but this is a whole electrical, you know, the devices, so electrical leakage, the connections and the environment is very, very important. From the inverter's point of view, you know, AC quality, how is coming out, you know, efficiency, noise and harmonics, voltage and current. So this has to be have a, you know, maintained on that optimum level, you know. Reliability to the grid linkage also, the switches, connectors, transformer, voltage and the current, these are all the things that one has to look into the, you know, most optimized way how to monitor. Then the warranty claims, the if this kind of a problem is comes in for the module failure for any kind of reasons, you know, how to get this kind of a warranty claim, the theft at site, spare management, the response time, you know. If it is a, as you know, the power plant is not in a very nicely located by the nearest airport, where sometimes you have to travel, you know, from the nearest airport 4 hours, 5 hours. So you have to see that how quick response, you know, is the time, you know. And the nature, sometimes, you know, because of the weather, if there is a huge rain and something like that, you know, how the water has to be drained. So there are some weather-related issues which come. The skilled manpower, normally, you know, you get in a big cities, you know, a very, you know, skilled manpower, the availability of the manpower for the operations analysis and the troubleshooting is also another issue, you know. Remote location execution challenge, like communication, connectivity, logistic for the repair, and the deployment of the manpower is also things, you know. So with my experience, you know, I try to see, you know, how you can, you know, protect for the interest. As you know, the solar module is one of the 60% of the whole project cost, you know. So how to see? So the module, when it is in the manufacturing, you get the best quality. There are several level of inspections. As you know, everybody in the contract, they put a third party, you know. In the third party, first they do the online manufacture, I mean, they check in the online manufacturing, then pre-dispatch. Sometimes they put these things in the third party laboratory to check the power you know, verification. Next thing is that the EL inspection to check the micro crack. Next is that what kind of the LID, you know, as per your data sheets, how this matches not, you know. Next is the PID, and finally, you know, the spectral response, you know. So there are several ways. You get the best module, but there are some challenges. Let us see in the packaging and the loading and transportations, how you are packaging the whole module, and then how you transport, whether the transportations, you know, it's coming in the right way to your site, you know. Next thing is the method of the unloading. You know, if you unload, you know, the most of the important part I had seen on the sides, you know, the side is not absolutely plain. You know, when you are taking out your pallet and, you know, putting into the plane, you know, this plane is a little bit uneven. These are very, very important factor, you know, how to unload, because there should not be any kind of a jerk or any kind of a, you know, mechanical shock that may create a kind of micro crack. And handling of this kind of module is very, very important, you know. You see how in India, you know, it happens, you know. If you see the after signing the PPA, you have a 12 months time, but 8 months time it goes for your land acquisitions and other things, you know. And finally, it may, because of the module cost is one of the highly capex cost. So it is coming by sea, and when it will reach in the sides, you have got only 1 month time. The people will work, you know, your sub vendors will work, you know, I mean, maybe day and night. So you have to see that at least two people, you know, it's not to carried by the, you know, head like that, you know. People should not sit on that particular module, you know. Should not put any kind of, you know, your the legs, or put any kind of a, you know, undeserved kind of a mechanical, you know, shocks, like sitting over there, and how to handle it, how to put it in the middle things. So improper handling and this kind of a, you know, unloading may cause a kind of a micro crack, and this micro cracks when it's separated, so the kind of the power what you are expecting, you don't get this kind of a, you know, power. Then the installations and the monitoring. You see the label here, you know, how the module has been, you know, installing here. There's a torque range, the tightening of this thing, the alignment of the whole thing, and then you have to check the polarity of the each module, you know, in the inverter label, or maybe in a SCB, you know, that each one is in the light polarity. Then cleaning of these things, you know, you should not use any kind of a, you know, kind of a abrasives or any other material for cleaning, and you have to see that it is rightly monitored. And the optimizing the PV performance, you know, is the things, you know. So most of the things is important, like in a individual module level or in a string level, you can measure the power by the IV tracer, you know. But these measurements, it's not the high accuracy measurement that you are expecting in the laboratory, you know. So something like plus minus 4% to 5% is the variation, but you can have an estimate on that, you know. Then the portable EL machine nowadays is very, very popular, you know, not in the daytime, this is in the nighttime. You can, you know, put in your, you know, in a string level or individual, in a module level, that if there is any kind of a micro crack, that you can check this kind of a tools, you know. Then another is that's very, very popular nowadays is the thermal imaging. The post installations, you know, you have to see that if there is a generation loss, you know, so you can appoint a third party. You know, there are several companies has come up, you know, particularly in India, there are two companies, but we are also talking some of the German companies to take the help, you know, if there is a kind of a, you know, peer is not achieving in a level like what were designed by the PVCs. So you can have a thermal imaging on that, you know. Now drone-based aerial inspections is also coming to be popular in future, because you can do kind of a 20 megawatt plant maybe in the 2 days time. So therefore it's very, very popular nowadays. Now this kind of things, you know, how it was shading due to the vegetation, how it can create a kind of, these are the, you know, the white areas, you know. So one should not see that how you you know, openly see, check that the vegetations may create this kind of problem, but nobody is telling you. But through the, you know, imaging, you can check this kind of thing. Some worm cells and the JB, you know, the worming also sometimes is happen, you know, there is some hot cells. So this is not as per the desired the module that you have expected, you know. So some hot cells are also may come because of the dust accumulations, you know. So something like thermal imaging, you also check your the cable fault or the interconnect, you know. So I have some numbers, but don't take it with the 20 megawatt kind of a operations management supervision. So manpower cost 20%, security cost is 15%, the spare power cost may be 22%, you know, and then the module cleaning 18%. So if you add like the supervision, security, this is more than, you know, I'll say 60% of the whole cost, you know, then grass cutting and all the other guest house and the vehicle maintaining, you know. So my conclusion is that recruit the experienced manpower from the previous industry to further move operations and the maintenance. Ensure the trained engineer follows the quality SOPs, you know, pre and the post installations. Educate the supervisors or sub inspector and sub vendors and the EPC player for the flawless installations. Use quality tools to monitor and improve the power plant performance and reduce O&M cost on a year-end basis. That is also the main objective on that, you know. So knowing all these points, that's true, we need to work together to improve our PP performance in future. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Moving on from Gautam sir's experience to somebody who comes from a different sector, Sushen Sharma sir, business head of India Locus Energy. I noticed, sir, that you had worked in multiple other organizations not linked to solar before you came in as a business head of Locus Energy. Would be very interesting to learn what we could learn from other sectors and implement in solar as well.
So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sushen and I represent Locus Energy in India. The topic of this session is data analytics and emerging technologies, and I will be speaking about how the data, the immense data that you're getting from your solar sites, can be simplified, channelized and used in order to maximize the returns, in order to maximize the ROI from your solar investments. Before that, just a little quick introduction. Locus Energy happens to be one of the largest independent monitoring providers in the world. We monitor more than 5.5 gigawatt that is spread across more than 150,000 sites. We entered in the India market very recently, about a year ago. And since then, we've been taking care of the international projects, everything outside of the US from India. So the agenda for the talk today is going to be very simple. I'm going to lead you through what the different kinds of data that you collect from the site and how what to look for in the data exactly, how we can break it down, sift through the data, and then focus on the areas where we can get maximum returns, and then solutioning, how we can make the solutions very simple. The scale of the industry. This is not something you don't know. In fact, you people are the ones who are making this possible. The solar in India has been growing at a tremendous rate. But the question that keeps coming up is that how do we make sense of the data that is coming in from these sites? How do we make sense of how well these sites are performing? What are the types of analytics that can help us perform better O&M? And are there certain parts of the O&M process that can be automated? So from the perspective of moving from a data analysis to a data intelligence point of view, Locus has been exploring, or rather has attempted to address the questions from two dimensions. The first is, how do we enable the O&M personnel to focus their time on where the issues are? So whether it is through automated alerts, whether it is through the analytics, we don't want you to be just struggling with the data. We want you to be able to know what or where the issues are and then spend time on them. The second aspect is what tools and approaches that can be created that can efficiently help figure the problems out. So for example, what are the different review, how can you review potential issues and dig in for the root cause analysis? What do we look for in the data? First thing is the loss that from any PV site is again notional. It depends on how accurately we are modeling what the possible performance could have been. So one of the first things, one of the basic fundamentals that become very important is how do we model what the perfect, or rather the maximum generation from a solar plant could have been. And this accurate modeling is something that that needs to be addressed, that needs to be taken care of when we're building our O&M models. And the second thing is that, okay, now that we know of what the losses are occurring, or rather what the total loss is, how do we isolate issues? How do we identify that what are the causes of all these losses? This comes from the perspective where the objective of every O&M personnel is different. It depends on what the size of the site is. It depends on where the geographical location of the sites is. It depends on the design. It also depends on the general O&M approach that the organization may adopt. Simply put, for smaller scale sites, shading may not be a terribly actionable issue, because nobody will put in special efforts to go and address a lot of soiling issues. Is not something that will be terribly actionable because nobody is going to spend any extra effort into say a lot of distributed solar sites. Whereas shading, in case of shading, if it's something that's built into the design already, it will be something that you can ignore. But if it's not, and if it's a problem that you're just facing on the site, then it's something that you need to look into. So how does analytics help us? What Locus has come up with is called the Locus VI waterfall, which is basically an automated analysis. How do we enable software to do the first cut analysis of the data that is coming in from your sites and help you focus your attention on where the issues are? So we have classified the losses into 7 broad areas. One is the clipping, snow losses, downtime. These are relatively the easier ones to identify. And going beyond them, the partial downtime, which we call the system loss in capacity, the soiling and shading and degradation, and then any other loss that we cannot fingerprint exactly goes into the last bracket. So in terms of how do we identify these losses, soiling and shading happen to be the most the acute ones that create a problem while identifying using software. The other losses, for example snow losses or partial downtime or downtime, are relatively easily identifiable and can be automated very easily. But when it comes to shading, once you have an idea of how your sun movements, the solar movement is, and how the array is positioned, and once you've cleanse the data and then strip down all other effects, you can get a good aspect, you can get a good idea of where the shading objects are located at any site, and where is that unfortunately located tree that is creating a problem or resulting in a lower production. So after that it comes to the soiling bit. Soiling can also, if you're doing an end-to-end analysis where you're comparing all the losses that are occurring at the plant, you can basically bring down, cut off all the other losses, do data cleansing, and then get to a point where you can come to say that, okay, over a period of time, and when you overlay that data with rainfall data and cleaning data, you can come to data that can point out to where the soiling losses or how much soiling losses are occurring, what is the quantum of the losses, and how quickly you need to do away with them. So over a period of time, the broad basing of losses creates a baseline estimate of and it gives you a wide opportunity to look into different kinds of losses that are occurring at any site. So the first thing that it helps you do is to focus your investigation or focus your time on where the issues are, like I said earlier. The second part is it helps you segregate the addressable issues from those that are non-addressable. So shading may probably be a non-addressable issue or may not be an issue that you can immediately rectify. Soiling is something that is rectifiable. Inverter, problems with the inverter are something that will need a corrective action immediately. Then we get to the third one, which is basically you can incorporate quantified seasonal or regional effects into your O&M plans. So if there's any particular area, we were talking about Rajasthan and how there's a lot of soiling that happens there. Your O&M plan would probably incorporate basis the readings or the losses that you get from your sites there. It can incorporate how your O&M approach should be for those, or the O&M plan should be for those sites. Then the next aspect is how do we look for meaningful trends in the results. Looking overall at the plant's performance, just one singular individual plant's performance, you may not be able to get or arrive to trend. To end, I would just like to give a thought out. You can all read already what's there on screen. But the fact is that at such conferences as this today, we tend to extol the opportunity of using technology, the latest technology, and how machines are going to take over and how everything is going to be replaced. But the key element is that as of today, machines can help you do the calculations faster, but the final decision making still rests and it still requires a human element. So focusing your energies is still something that you will have to decide. We can only help you do it faster. Thank you.